evening, everyone.
Evening.
My name is Colin Ashley, and I am an activist and organizer with the People's Powers Assembly. And I'm also aka the PPA. I am also a PhD candidate here at the CUNY Graduate Center in Sociology. Thank you. we know Colin. What this crowd, what's going on. Right? And it is an honor to be on the stage with these amazing activists here tonight, and an honor to welcome you all to this amazing event, Women Rising Up. So one more round of applause for all of the activists. So tonight's event was organized by two grassroots social justice organizations dedicated to racial justice, dismantling patriarchy, fighting LGBTQ oppression, and standing up for immigrant and workers' rights. The PPA, People's Powers Assembly, and May 1st Coalition. And the event was also organized by two student groups here at the Graduate Center, CUNY, the LGBTQ student org here, and the Africana Studies group. And I'd also like to briefly acknowledge the generous support and co-sponsorship we received for the event from IRIDAC, the Institute for Research on the African Diaspora in the Americas and the Caribbean. The Post-Colonial Studies Group, the Sociology Program, the Sociology Students Association, and the Doctoral Students Council, all here at the Graduate Center. So Alicia Garza, one of the queer black women who created the Black Lives Matter hashtag, has described the Black Lives Matter movement as an ideological and political intervention in a world where black lives are systematically and intentionally targeted for demise. She goes on, though, to explicitly state that this intervention must affirm the lives of black, queer, and trans folks, disabled folks, undocumented folks, folks with criminal records, women, and all black lives along the gender spectrum. So this event was organized in that spirit to uplift and highlight the roles of women and queer and trans folk concurrently taking the lead in movements to challenge and dismantle the multiple forms of state violence being waged against people of color, immigrants, women, and LGBTQ individuals. Tonight, we hope to have a lively discussion about social justice movements, how women and other marginalized folks continue to take the lead in such movements, despite their leadership positions still being made invisible or seemingly unimportant. So next, I'd like to introduce another organizer and activist, Teresa Gutierrez, with the May 1st Coalition, to also discuss the importance of tonight's events, and then we'll jump into it. Thank you all.
Buenas tardes. Si se puede.
Si se puede.
Long live the power of the women. I want to tell you a little bit about the May 1st Coalition, which was formed in 2006. And I have to tell you that I have been dreaming about a meeting like this since 2006. Our coalition was formed in 2006, like many other immigrant rights groups, but we were one of those that said, we don't believe in the formulation comprehensive immigration reform. We demanded full rights and immediate legalization for all the undocumented. We are a unique coalition because we stood for international global solidarity and we opposed war everywhere that the Pentagon went. And from day one, our coalition stood with the black community. We marched for Sean Bell in 2006, and every year we try to find a way to bring in the case of our beloved brother, Mumia Abu-Jamal. So today, I am elated that the organizations listed here brought you these three amazing sisters, these three fierce warriors who stood their ground. They and the movement that they reflect are the real answer to the racist cops who have gotten away with murder. Now, I want to bring up Donald Trump for just a minute. Because this ignorant, idiot man has escalated racism. A man, while he beat up a Latino immigrant in Boston, urinated on the worker and said Donald Trump was right. And even if Trump has not addressed the Black Lives Matter movement by name, his demagogy and rhetoric is nonetheless directed at the Black community. Let us remember that it was Trump who called for the death penalty in 1989 in the case of the Central Park Five, even though these brothers were innocent. And as we witness the horrors in Europe, tens of thousands from Africa who die in the waters, millions more escaping U.S. war in Syria, let us take the inspiration that Bree, Jennicet, and Marilyn have given us to build our movement, and be sure to check out the action on September 26th in solidarity with the immigrants of Europe that the May 1st and other groups are organizing, and is in solidarity with the workers from Mexico. And finally, I can't speak anywhere without speaking about May Day. So I want to ask everyone now to mark your calendar, not just to come to the rally at Union Square on May the 1st, but to start now to work with all the organizations here tonight and elsewhere to start thinking about another kind of May Day, one that is sparked by the one in 2006, where immigrants and their supporters shut Wall Street down and cost the Wall Street profiteers millions of dollars in profits, and shut it down as immigrant rights activists are doing right now in Washington State. On the 10th year anniversary of May Day next year, let's start talking about a May Day that tells Trump and all the presidential candidates that lets racist killer cops know that we are not going back, that we stand with those like Marilyn, like Bree and Jennicet, that will do everything we can to fight for our rights. That's the kind of May Day that we need next year. One that says immigrant lives matter, trans lives matter, women's lives matter, poor people's lives matter, and all lives would matter when Black lives matter. Thank you.
All right, are you guys ready to hear from these warriors over here? Let's hear it. All right, I'm gonna give a brief description of the struggle of each of these women, and then we're gonna have 10 or 15 minutes where we will hear from them. And they will tell us more about their struggle. So Marilyn Zuniga. Was a first year teacher in the Orange Township, New Jersey public schools. In the spring of 2015, Marilyn was terminated from her teaching position at Forest Street Elementary School because she allowed her third grade students to send get well cards to Mumia Abu-Jamal, the beloved Pennsylvania political prisoner. This unjust termination has been fought by her countless supporters. She has been called the model teacher. Everyone has stated that her students were flourishing and she was valued by parents. She is currently a community organizer in Newark, New Jersey. Next we have Jennicet Gutiérrez. A Mexican undocumented trans woman active in the immigration and LGBTQ movements. Boldly, she took center stage at the White House event when she courageously called out President Barack Obama on his policies on migrant detentions. As Obama began to deliver his speech at the LGBTQ Pride event hosted by the White House, Gutierrez interrupted him by declaring, "President Obama, release all LGBTQ immigrants from detention. I am tired of the violence we are facing." Also, we have Bree Newsome. On June 27th, 2015, Bree Newsome scaled the flagpole on the South Carolina State House grounds and removed the racist symbol of slavery, the Confederate flag. With the assistance of black and white comrades, Newsome carried out the act of heroic defiance and that resonated to all of us in the struggle. Bree Newsome and James Tyson, who assisted her from the ground, were subsequently arrested. Newsome is now facing up to 3 years in jail if convicted. Activists are demanding that all charges be dropped against Bree. Bree's courage in challenging white supremacy is truly astounding. All right, so we want to open up the floor and give Marilyn a chance to speak, and then Jennicet, and then Bree. And then we will open up the floor for you all for questions. So go ahead.
Thank you so much. I want to start off by just saying that y'all are beautiful. I'm looking at the crowd and I'm overwhelmed with all the energy in this room. I want to say thank you, a special thank you to People's Power Assembly and also May 1st Coalition for having me today. I'm absolutely honored and super blessed to be at a table with so much powerful people. So I want to start off today by just giving a brief update and a synopsis of what happened with my particular case. And then I want to give a little bit of a storytelling of how I got here in the first place. So I want to start off by saying I was a third grade teacher in Orange, New Jersey. And I became passionate about being a teacher, very ironically, because I hated school. And I started that journey really my senior year of high school, and I realized that there was a cultural mismatch between my educators and myself and my family, my culture, my language. And from there, I decided to take on the route of becoming a teacher because I really found it the place and calling for me to do the work that I've always wanted to be done in my life. And so I really wanted to become the teacher that I never had. And so in my storytelling, you'll hear a little bit about that journey. But just to be more specific, as a third grade teacher in Orange, New Jersey, I was teaching predominantly black and Latino students. And throughout the year, we explored a lot of social justice topics, a lot of topics that many folks might consider controversial. And so we talked about the Black Lives Matter movement. We talked about immigration. We talked about certain cases that were going around in the world, that were going on around the world, that were affecting our families, that were affecting our communities. And so my students became very, very passionate about all of these things. For the month of February, we did a we did a series of civil rights leaders, and we explored leaders that are oftentimes not seen in textbooks, oftentimes not covered in curriculum that's in the Common Core. And so a lot of these leaders are names like Ella Baker, Ida B. Wells, Angela Davis, Assata Shakur. And on today, most importantly, Mumia Abu-Jamal. And so it's no surprise that my students became captivated with Mumia's story, because I don't know who could read about Mumia's story or hear Mumia's voice and not be captivated by the power in his voice, the power in his story. And so when I shared the work that Mumia has done in his community of Philadelphia with my students, they became very passionate about Mumia. They went home, they did research on Mumia. It wasn't required work, it wasn't required homework, and any of us who are educators and teachers in here know how difficult it is to get students to do required homework, let alone homework that you did not assign. And so that was obviously a light bulb moment for me as a public school teacher, and it was just a moment that was so captivating and so powerful. And so in the month of April, when Mumia became very sick, very ill, and he was hospitalized, but he wasn't giving the treatment that he rightfully deserved. He was diagnosed with hepatitis C, he's diabetic, and he was basically on his deathbed. He's still not doing well today, as many of us know. And so my students, when they heard this, and when they heard that he was not allowed to see his family, and they weren't allowing family and friends to visit him, they were really upset. And they became very passionate about it. So they asked me, Ms. Zuniga, can we write letters to Mumia to make him feel better? And I said, of course you can. And so I've always encouraged my students, anyone who I'm mentoring, anyone who I consider myself as a teacher to express themselves through writing. And so I was really excited that one of my students asked this. And so they went on and made these letters, these cards, and they were absolutely beautiful. They didn't just have beautiful words of encouragement and love, but they had beautiful pictures. And so when they were done making these letters, one of my students looked up at me and she said, Ms. Zuniga, can you get these letters to Mumia? Mm-hmm. And I said, baby, I don't know if that's gonna happen. I really didn't think it was gonna happen at the moment. I thought that, you know, they would write these letters, I would review them. And I would get obviously emotional and very, very empowered by them, and that they would be able to take it home as a memory for them. When I spoke to a professor here at Baruch College by the name of Johanna Fernandez, she said, I'm going to deliver those letters to Mumia. And those letters were in Mumia's hand that following Sunday. So I want to share with you all that when Mumia read those letters, it was particularly special to him that they were letters from third graders, that they were letters from elementary students. He loves kids, you know, and a lot of folks who are close to Mumia know this about him. And so they were ecstatic to hear that he got letters from third graders in a public school. He stood up that day. He hadn't stood up in a really, 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 really long time. He wanted to take pictures. He was smiling. He was able to express emotion that he wasn't able to express in a long time due to his illness. So I want to share a little bit about my story and how I got here today. As a child and throughout my teenage years, I never understood why my parents left Lima, Peru to come here. And by here, I mean specifically Livingston, New Jersey. A small bubble that some people call a town that is populated by predominantly white, Jewish, middle, upper class families. I never fit in. I was brown and all my classmates were white. I spoke Spanish, they spoke English. I didn't understand why my parents would stick me in a school where I couldn't communicate with the other kids. A community where I was constantly told to go back to my country, to learn to speak English. My middle school principal hated me. I was always in his office for wearing short skirts, spaghetti straps, and chewing gum. But that's what all the girls in middle school did, only I was a little curvier than the rest, a little browner toned than the other girls in my school, my thighs too thick and sexy to show off on school grounds. It seemed short and spaghetti straps were against the school code of conduct only when you are a girl of color, because unfortunately, we are hypersexualized at far too young of an age. Our bodies are desired, yet demonized, objectified, yet ostracized, sexualized, yet shamed, exoticized, yet exploited. I hated school, and I couldn't wait to get out. I didn't understand why my parents left such a beautiful, beautiful culture to live in an area where it was completely devalued. I didn't understand why my parents would put me in a school system like Livingston, where I noticeably didn't belong, where my parents worked tirelessly to rent out a small portion of a multifamily home shared among 10 of us, where we struggled to have the essentials, food on the table, clothes on our back, and a good education, where we looked around to only see soccer moms driving Range Rovers and Livingston girls rocking every ugly colored UGG boot you can think of. Not only did I receive hate from my peers with their xenophobic comments and racial slurs, but I experienced an imposition of deficit thinking from teachers and administration. Zuniga was a last name that teachers, principals, and guidance counselors all prejudged and prepared for. Yes, the Zuniga familia left its fair mark in Livingston Public Schools, a district that has produced people like Governor Chris Christie, a suburban district that paid over $1.5 million to shift its state-of-the-art track and field over a few inches so that they could fit a few more rows of bleachers to showcase their less-than-mediocre football team. I didn't understand why my parents made all the sacrifices they made for this. But now I understand. My family's journey is the epitome of the immigrant story. Pursuing the American dream, undocumented, and assimilating into a culture with endless opportunity and a merit system where we, as hardworking Latinos, will surely thrive. Oh yes, we know how to work hard. We know damn well how to work hard. But what many of us don't know, unfortunately, is that our work ethic does not outweigh our citizenship status, does not outweigh our brown skin. Just like I didn't understand them growing up, my parents don't really understand why I do the things I do today. They didn't understand why once I was an adult, I decided to move to the city where I was born, Newark, New Jersey. A city, yes. A city where 25 years ago, my mama, with me in her belly, would catch the bus knocking from door to door selling Mary Kay products. A city that is nothing like Livingston, nothing even close to the standards that they desired me to assimilate to. A city that they believe is one of the most dangerous places in the country. Well, their eyes are stuck on mainstream media like CNN and Fox. What else are they going to believe? They don't understand why I won't just work in a suburban school system. They don't understand why I won't just work somewhere where there's white students and not black and brown students. They don't understand why I'm passionate about social justice teaching or culturally relevant pedagogy. They don't understand why I care about these things, but I need them to. I need them to understand why. I need them to understand that the same news that they're watching about the city of Newark comes from the same news outlets that demonize their daughter as a cop killer loving teacher. I need them to understand that our immigrant story is an exception to the rule and in fact quite imaginary. I need them to understand that our people are eating crumbs while a selective few are eating full course meals. But most importantly, I need them to understand that this is bigger than me or the success of our family within the context of the so-called American dream. I need them to understand that the system is set up so that we don't make it. The system is set up so that our black and brown babies don't succeed in the false promise of the American dream. It's set up so that most states spend 3 to 4 times more capita incarcerating prisoners than they do educating our students. So that mandatory minimums for drug violations keep our communities locked down in a vicious cycle of incarceration. So that 1 in 3 young black men are currently under the control of the criminal justice system. So that our black and brown youth are disproportionately expelled and suspended in our public schools. It's set up so that 17-year-old Jessica Hernandez is blamed for her own death when it was clearly a violent act of homophobic and racist hatred by Denver police. It's set up so that 12-year-old Tamir Rice can't play in his community playground without getting shot by Cleveland police. It's set up so that 10-year-old Andres Jimenez is scarred for life from his father's deportation, and it's set up so that 77-year-old Ayanna Jones can't sleep peacefully at night without Detroit's SWAT team coming in and killing her during a drug raid. I need them to understand that our struggle is with our people, and that my American dream looks a little different. That my American dream involves us as a people fighting against and dismantling the white supremacist, capitalist, heteropatriarchy as we know it. And most of all, what I really want them to understand is that the sacrifices that they made and the sacrifices I make and we make as a people are actually for the same reason. They're for our future, and they're for our babies. Thank you.
That was beautiful. Thank you. Jennicet?
Muy buenas noches a todos aquí presentes. Gracias por invitarme. Es mi primera vez en Nueva York. Estoy un poco nerviosa de estar en esta ciudad. Pero quiero darle la gracia a los organizadores de este evento, a mis compañeras guerreras tan fuertes que me inspiran a mí también. People's Power Assembly por tener este evento tan importante. Before I start, good evening, everyone. I want to thank everyone being here, the organizers, my amazing, powerful, inspirational warriors that have inspired me to also act and get out of my comfort zone. Everyone here present, this is my first time in New York, so I will do my best, not today. I always wanted to come to New York, but I didn't know how or when, but today, it's a very good way to come, right? Not to celebrate, but to speak up on the injustices that our community are facing. And before I get into those details, I do want to read some names of transgender women and gender nonconforming people who have been killed in 2015. I think it's a minute that we should honor their lives. So I'm going to read their names. 1, Papi Edwards. 2, Taja Gabriel de Jesus. 3, Bree Golick. 4, Lamia Bird. 5, Ty Underwood. 6, Jasmine Vash Payne. 7, Penny Proud. 8, Christina Grant Infinity. 9, Maya Hall. 10, London Chanel. 11, Mercedes Williamson. 12, India Clark. 13, Casey Haggard.
Say her name.
14, Shade Schiller. 15, Amber Monroe.
Ashe.
16, Candice Capri.
Ashe.
17, Alicia Walker.
Say her name.
18, Ashton O'Hara.
Say her name.
19, Tamara Dominguez.
Say her name.
20, Giovanna Luna. Also, please keep in mind Christina, who is currently in detention for over a year and a half in Santa Ana, and ICE refuses to provide much needed medical care. She has hepatitis C. Thank you. The interruption at the White House wasn't about just me. It is about the continuous state-sanctioned violence and oppression my community faces every day. It is about the silence inflicted upon us by the media and the mainstream LGBTQ community. How did I get to the White House? I became involved in activism because those names, first 20 names that I read to you, they don't have a voice. They are no longer with us because of the transphobic violence that we face on a daily basis. So to me, I started to get involved, and I want to thank Familia Trans Queer Liberation Movement for giving me that opportunity to be able to navigate the activism and what it really means to be part of a movement. I also want to take Isa Noyola, who is an amazing, passionate fighter in our community for our voices, and Jorge Gutierrez, who is the founder of Familia Trans Queer Liberation Movement, and also Bambi Salcido, who has been doing such amazing activist work in LA. So to me, participating in these interruptions was both personal, and it was a voice that I needed, a presence that much needs to be visible in our times. I remember growing up, and I was always told to respect authority, always listen, and never interrupt. But going into this event, into this space, how could I not interrupt and be disrespectful when our lives are being interrupted daily? We are interrupted at the doctor's office because we want to start hormone therapy, and we are told that that's not a town to do so. We are interrupted with family because we express our concerns that we want to transition. We are interrupted at work because we don't have a social security number. So to me, going into the White House, it wasn't nothing to celebrate. And it was one of the most challenging yet difficult moments at this point. But given the opportunity, without hesitation, I will do it again. And if you look at my Facebook, I'm a selfie queen. I was so tempted to take selfies, but I say no. Jenny said, you are here on a mission. Don't forget what you are doing here, so leave your phone alone. And I remember taking a photo, and I was drinking a glass of champagne, and then Jorge was like, girl, don't get drunk. I was like, no, I'm not. This is just one to relax. I need to relax. You know who I'm about to see? The President of the United States. Hello. Anyways, then the media blew it up and accused me of being drunk and wasted years to attack the message, to attack my credibility, and most important, to attack the message. Right. But guess what? I am fighting back, and that message will be heard. Power should always be interrupted when given the opportunity, especially from people supposed to be powerless. I believe that in this act of resistance, I have found my liberation. For many years, I lived in shame, shame of being a transgender woman of color, shame of being undocumented. Now that I have released my chains of shame, I want my beloved undocumented trans and queer community to find their own power and liberation. I don't want to assimilate into the system that doesn't value diversity. So that is my lifelong commitment. Trans and queer liberation now. So I remember going into the White House, and obviously it was intentional. As an activist, we should know the least concern we should have in our minds is respectability politics. And I remember calling my mother and telling her, oh, guess what, mother, me voy para la Casa Blanca. She's like, oh, mija, I'm so proud of you. Yes. I take a photo, you know, una foto con Obama and tell him I say hi, you know. And I was like, and then my brothers and sisters, we are so proud of you. And, you know, take a photo with Obama and tell him we say hi, you know, things like that. But they didn't really know what the important message that I had to deliver. So, you know, being in that space with my own, I just cannot give a talk without addressing how divided we are within our own LGBTQ community. The reaction that they gave me, it was like something that has been happening for the last, since our movement began, with the amazing leadership of Marsha P. Johnson. Sylvia Rivera, which I am so honored that she was from New York, and I'm here feeling her spirit and fighting back. I'm Miss Major Jones. So to me at that moment, it was like something took over me because I was so stressed out and how do I do this? Do I do it? I was fighting with myself. I was insecure. I was nervous. I was like, am I going to pass out? What's going to happen to me? Do I listen to my mother and, you know, be respectful and let the president speak? Mm-hmm. But at that moment, my ancestors came through me and said, this is the time. It is a critical time. Mm-hmm. Our brothers and sisters are dying, mm-hmm. and you cannot celebrate. Mm-hmm. So finally, a fragile voice soared to the crowd and said, President Obama, release all LGBTQ detainees in detention centers. The voice soared and said, I am tired of the violence trans and gender nonconforming people face daily in this country that is supposed to celebrate diversity. So basically, I just had to speak up at that moment and make sure my voice and the voice of those who are no longer with us was heard. By interrupting power, we manifest liberation. Being transgender and being undocumented are meant to be powerless. Yet again, I show that we can be powerful. I also want to thank my partner, Tommy, who's here with his sister. It is well known by the U.S. Immigration and Customs Enforcement that the Department of Homeland Security and President Obama that trans women are often sexually abused while in detention. This awareness is largely due to the work of many other organizations and activists who would not allow politeness to get in the way of exposing injustice to the world. In conclusion, I have a vision that our community will continue to unite and show our power. We all must develop a vision of change and leadership and commit to acts of resistance. We must not assimilate into a system that wants to destroy our vision, and our movement must be led now and always by the voices who have been constantly ignored, trans women of color. Thank you.
Thank you for your bravery, Jennicet. Now we have Bree Newsome.
Hi, good evening. Thank you so much. I know there were several organizations that made this event happen. Thank you to you all, and thank you to everyone for coming out. I was so excited when I got the reach out to come to this event. I do a lot of since the action, I've been doing a lot of traveling around, and a lot of the, you know, forums that I speak in, honestly, the first question is, why did you take down the flag? And I'm like,
Wait.
That's what I'm doing on the inside. I don't do it. I collect myself, and then I say, well, there's this thing called history. But it's always just interesting, like when people ask me, why did you take down the Confederate flag? It's kind of like asking, why do you want to breathe? Why do you want to be free? Right. You know? Why are you not willing to sacrifice your soul and your self-identity for the sake of cultural hegemony? You know? When the real question should be, why in 2015 are states still sponsoring racism? Why is there still a monument to white supremacy and racism flying outside the state capital of South Carolina? Like, let's talk about that. Can I answer that question? I did not consider myself an activist. I didn't think of myself as an activist, at least, until really like the past 2 years. It was in the aftermath of the Trayvon Martin case that I jumped into, you know, the movement like a lot of other people did. And I found it really interesting and deeply disturbing when I saw the manifesto from Dylann Roof that was also when he, you know, that triggered something in him as well, which reminded me as always that, you know, on one side, you know, there's certain events that happen, we're having one reaction over here, and there's still this very, you know, real faction of the country that's having a very opposite reaction. You know, in 2008, I was like, a lot of people, I was like, we turned the corner. We don't, you know, not very naive now, right? You know, but at the time, you know, I was like, yeah, maybe this really does mark something new. We've elected a black president, you know. At the same time, that sparked this whole new surge in white supremacist groups, you know. And the thing that is so disturbing about it is that when we had something happen like the Charleston massacre, because we don't teach history, because there's, apart from the threat of violence, of physical violence, in terms of challenging the status quo, there's also this kind of polite society, this other form of violence, which is silence, right? We don't talk about the history of racial terror in this country. You know, we don't talk about how there's a long history of attacks on churches and against black people who, every time black people have tried to organize for any kind of economic and political power in this country. I grew up in Columbia, Maryland, which is, nobody knows about Columbia, Maryland, do you? Shut up. Oh, really? Awesome. We're on the map. but it's this suburb between Washington, D.C. and Baltimore, and it was this, you know, kind of planned community, and there are a lot of things about it that were, you know, that were really great. We had, like, mixed-income housing. I grew up with a lot of diversity, but at the same time, I still saw the inequality happening. From, like, you know, fourth grade on, I, you know, was placed in these gifted and talented classes, as they call them. Which my mom had to fight for because my teachers felt that I was neither gifted nor talented enough. I'm sure it had nothing to do with me being black. But you know, from that point on, I saw the clear division. I would be like the only black kid in my classes going forward. You know, and as a child, again, there's like this culture of silence. We don't talk about it. But it's very clear. And then I actually came to, I did college at NYU, actually. NYU, cool. And I took a class on race and ethnicity, which was actually one of the most, like, eye-opening courses that I had, you know, ever taken, because it was the first time that, you know, you can see things, you can feel things, you can be aware of things, but it's hard to, like, put a name to it. It's hard to label it until you see it. And that was the first time that I learned the term colorblind racism. I was like, I'm not crazy! Like, there's definitely this culture where we, this thing now where we act like racism doesn't exist, you know, it's not there, you know. So when people ask me why we took the Confederate flag down, I point to, you see the people at Stone Mountain having a Klan rally, you see the people out front, that's why we took it down. Because when we do that, you can no longer deny. When you see the reaction, you can no longer deny. We had to take the flag down for the same reason that people would sit in at the lunch counter, to force that kind of reaction, right? Because see, you know, it's not until the riots happen that everybody says, there's violence. It's gotten violent. We want to restore peace. There is no peace. There's no peace. Poverty is violence. Racism is violence. A symbol of the Confederacy, a symbol that is held up by white supremacists for a hundred years, a racial terror flying over a state capital that people drive by every day, is violence. So I got into the movement in 2013. There in North Carolina, I began like with the Moral Monday movement, where we were like protesting over voting rights. And and the thing that was so, I think, what struck a very personal note for me when the Charleston massacre happened, over the course of those 2 years, you know, I had been present for a lot of actions. You know, we did a sit-in at the state capitol in North Carolina, where I was arrested trying to draw attention to voting rights. I participated in a lot of marches. We did voter registration. We did kind of like a commemorative Freedom Summer in 2014. And a lot of things felt kind of like, you know, referential actions to the past, you know, kind of like a nod to the past. But the feeling was still that the past was the past. You know, the first moment that I had that really kind of brought home to me the reality of the level of violence that a lot of, especially civil rights workers in the 60s faced. I was trying to do voter registration at a library in my neighborhood, and there was an officer on duty at the library, and he just like came over and he was like, you know, looking through my stuff like, so what you got here? You know, what are you doing? Just like in a very intimidating kind of way. And I went home that night, and I heard like some kind of bang outside. It just like made me jump. And at that moment, it kind of like flashed through my mind. Like there was a time when people were doing what I was doing, and there might be like a cross burning outside in their yard right now, you know? And then Ferguson happened, and it was like Ferguson was like the first moment where I realized like we could still lose our lives for doing this kind of work, you know? And then the night of the Charleston massacre, you know, it was like the 16th Street bombing. And then to get up the next day and see a lot of society just going on, you know, a lot of people just kind of going about their daily lives like, you know, like this hadn't happened, was just so deeply disturbing. You know, in Alabama, they took the flag down right away, but in South Carolina, they were continuing to debate it. And I think the turning point for me particularly was when it became very clear that they were going to allow the American flag and the state flag to be at half staff while the Confederate flag was flying at full staff as Reverend Pinckney's body passed underneath. To me, was just the ultimate offense that could no longer be tolerated. I live in Charlotte, North Carolina. I'm a local organizer there. And, you know, we're just an hour from Columbia, South Carolina. And so that flag, even though it is, you know, across the border in another state, it still deeply impacts us. The Klan rally that was held there, that group of Klan came from North Carolina down to South Carolina. So this notion, first of all, injustice anywhere is relevant to everybody everywhere. I don't recognize your borders when it comes to injustice. you know, like Martin Luther King, we're going there because injustice is there. But you know, for a long time, even like several months before this happened, you know, I had talked with activists that I work with there in Charlotte, and we were like, you know what, dream action, I would love to do, man, I want to go take down that Confederate flag. And I think that's how, you know, that's how a lot of people felt, but then obviously once the massacre happened, it kind of tipped it to another level. And I wish I had my friend here who could testify. He really had to talk me down. I was like, tell me again why I shouldn't go down and take this flag down right now. He was like, that's not wise, Bree, that's not wise. And so when I was approached by an action coordinator that I know, and he said, well, you know, I've looked at it and I think logistically we could, you know, really make the flag action happen. And I was like, absolutely, like, you know, let's do it. We had a meeting that Tuesday evening where we kind of like went over, you know, logistically how could this happen, what would be the different roles. You know, obviously the person who volunteered to climb the pole would be at risk of being arrested, as would the person who stood at the bottom, that was James Tyson, who was arrested along with me. But even the other people, and there were about eight other people involved in this action, you know, were really putting themselves at risk, because at that point, you know, we didn't know, what might they bring, you know, conspiracy charges. We really didn't know what the full extent of you know, the legal ramifications might be. Making the decision to volunteer was the easy part, actually. It was the days between that were a bit more difficult, because I had to kind of, you know, that evening I went home and my nieces were over at the house. I had my grandmother there, and I couldn't tell, you know, I couldn't tell anyone about what I was going to do. And I, you know, as much as, and I want to be clear, I know a lot of people are, you know, comparing me to Rosa Parks and things like that. I think that's amazing. I feel really honored to you know, be placed in that category. It's hard for me to view myself that way, because, you know, I feel like I'm just a person who cared about an issue and I wanted to take a stand. But I will say that experience and that particular night just gave me so a much deeper respect for what people did to get us where we were. You know, I was sitting there that night, I was thinking about the Freedom Riders. I was thinking about these young people who got on a bus to go down and they didn't know if they were gonna make it back, you know? And who am I in this moment to not take that stand? You know, if it's my turn to get on the bus, like, who am I to walk away? The ball would not be where it was if it was not for those people. And so, you know, I prayed on it a lot, and, you know, decided that we had to do it for a number of reasons, but also because I just refuse to let fear have the final say. I refuse to let fear, violence, hatred, racism, xenophobia, bigotry, have white supremacy continue to have the final say. This status quo is held in place by the threat of violence and by fear. And that was exactly what Dylann Roof demonstrated when he went into that church. Forgive me for a second.
Okay.
I'm sorry, it's just so much sometimes. Like, it was just... I felt everyone with me when I was on that. Like, I can't explain it to you, but it was like I felt it, you know? I felt everyone with me. I felt like it wasn't just me on that pole. It was everybody who had seen that flag and wanted to bring that flag down. It was everybody who had been fighting for so long. And I think that's why, as much as I love, you know, the Wonder Woman cartoons and all that, like that's amazing. And I mean, it's really amazing. Like, I love it. I'm so deeply touched by it. But I want people to also just recognize that how human I am. I'm a human being. I didn't know how to climb a pole. I didn't learn how to climb a pole. I'm just impulsive. I'm just an impulsive person. Honestly, like, even with the movement, it was like I went to a moral Monday and Wednesday I was arrested. Like, I was like, yeah, let's do it. They're like, hey, we need more people to get arrested. Yeah, let's go. Shut it down. you know? So, yeah. So I was like, yeah, let's go take down the flag. That could be dangerous. Whatever. But no, I really want people to know. I want people to know that I'm human. I'm not a climbing expert. I'm not. It was an activist from Greenpeace who taught me how to climb in like a day and a half. And the reason I want to say that is because I think that so often we really underestimate how much power we have as individuals. And so a huge part as well of maintaining this status quo, this oppressive status quo, is the constant disempowering of individuals and of collectives and of communities. And I think I just always want to drive that home so that, you know, I know I was invited here to talk about myself, but I always have to end with talking about everyone, with talking about you, and just driving home again, like, we have the power to change things. The status quo is a construct. This is a human construct. Anything that people construct can be deconstructed, reconstructed, changed. We don't have to accept it. And the reason that we took down the flag is I refuse to accept this, tolerate this this level of disrespect anymore. And I'm going to wrap up, sorry. But I just say repeatedly, I drive home the point that we were arrested. The charges that we have, and we, you know, faced trial on November 19th, was for defacing state property, which, first of all, I would argue we did not deface state property because I simply unhooked the flag, took it down the pole, and it was raised back up in 45 minutes. I mean, objectively speaking, that's what happened. The possible 3 years that we face in jail is because we challenged the white power structure. I mean, that's really what it's about. And that's why we have already spent more time in jail than the cop who assaulted a black girl at a pool party in McKinney. We've already spent more time in jail than the cop who killed Tamir Rice. And so I just really want to leave everyone with this idea. We collectively have so much more power than we give ourselves credit for. This action was not done by any organization. This was literally a group of activists, 10 activists sitting in a living room that somebody allowed us to do, and we said, we're not going to wait on you to tell us what justice is. We're going to make justice happen today. Thank you.
Want to now open the floor for questions. We have two mics on the end. If you have a question, would you please line up at the mics? There is also a collections bucket going around. If you would like to donate to help do this again, please throw some dollars in.
Thank you.
Each person has 2 minutes.
Hello.
Testing.
Monica, will you test that mic?
Testing.
Okay. All right. Also, if you have a question, can you please say the person it is directed at? Monica, let's start with you.
Yeah, I'm with Monica with Workers' World Party and with Millions from EMEA. And I have questions for, anyway, the talks were amazing. Just amazing, so inspiring. I wish, you know, millions of people could hear this, and we'll try to get it out to as many people as possible, I'm sure. But I had one question for Bree and one question for Marilyn. And I just wanted to know, in terms of Marilyn's situation, in terms of your situation, what's the status of your, you know, the termination? Are you fighting to try to get your job back? What's happening with that process? How can we continue to support you in that effort, if that's what's happening? And with Bree, when you talked about your court case on November 19th, are you urging people, you and James, to pack the courthouse? What exactly can we as activists, whether we're in Columbia, South Carolina, or outside of Columbia, what can we do to support and show solidarity? Because we can't rely on the state to do what it's supposed to do, which is to drop these charges, which you should not have ever been arrested in the first place, but they're there. So how can we continue to show solidarity with both of the cases?
All right, let's start with Marilyn.
Yes, thank you for that question. It's so important. So I want to first say that I want to emphasize the importance of community organizers and activists in my case. So when I was initially suspended with pay, there was board meetings. There was two consecutive board meetings a month apart that the community attended. And so I had a choice whether to make it an executive session private or to make it public where the community can attend. And it was solely because of the power of the community and the people that showed up that the Board of Education, the board members, felt threatened. And that's why they decided to terminate me. And so I want to say that there's power in that. There's power in the fact that community came together and made that happen. I did not make that happen. And so I want to also answer the question of how you can support today. Currently, politically, what we are looking to do is get me back in the classroom. And so that's our main goal as of right now. There's a lot of communities that came in support of me and my case, and that's what we're trying to do. So we're trying to, most importantly, find administration principals that are supportive of my case, that are supportive and want a teacher like me in their school and in a classroom.
Yes, so as I was mentioned, my trial date is November 19th in Columbia, South Carolina. You know, I'm not great at asking people to do stuff like that. Like, I don't, you know, and I really appreciate the support. I think, you know, people who are definitely local, I'm asking, like, if they want to come out and support, absolutely. You know, if you're up in New York, a great way to support me is to support James and I is to tweet at the legislatures, tweet at the governor. You know, just let people know that we are still facing these charges. I think a lot of people assume that the charges would be dropped, right. You know, that the charges are dropped, but they actually were not. I honestly don't expect them to come down hard on us unless they want to take me from Rosa Parks to Angela Davis.
Right.
listen, the movement can continue in jail. But yes, absolutely. Absolutely, I would love it if anybody who could come out to support us in person would be great. Just continuing to raise the issue on social media and let people know that we are still facing this. And the fact that the charges are sticking again, because it's not about a flag, it's because we challenge the power structure.
Right. Right.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Shahid Comrade, and I'm a Secretary General of Pakistan USA Freedom Forum, and proud member from the day one of the People's Assembly and the May First Coalition for the Workers' Right. I think it's one of the sweetest evenings in this town that we have very young women or men, whatever you want to call, who stand against the system which is taking away from the humanity. And you just remind me, women, two women from my country, Pakistan, who's standing against the whole CIA dirty game in Pakistan. I'm talking about the missing people, and I'm talking about the sister, elder sister of Dr. Rafia Siddiqui. Her name is Fawzia Siddiqui. She's standing against the whole system. And please let us know, any one of you, what we can do to have a good name of this country, the country which is stand for the humanity and the respect for the justice of the all laws, resolution of the United Nations, and what we can do. And being a Pakistani, I will mention you, and I'm very much proud of you, because you make us the proud from this country. You tell the whole world that we are the real American who stand for the love and peace and even equal rights for everybody. Thank you for your services. And being a teacher, Miss, you give us the good message. And we never make you put you down, and we will write down every letter to everywhere, every person who needs the help. God bless our country, God bless this world. Thank you.
Thank you. This mic over here.
I have a question for Bree. what can the kids do to help with this?
I'm sorry?
What can the kids do to help with the active?
Yeah, well, you're already way cooler than I was at your age. Because I was not at forums asking what can I do in terms of activism. So you're already way more conscious than I was at your age, and that's amazing. But I think that I love talking to young people. Like, that's one of the things that I really love to do is talk to students and youth. I was just in DC speaking at a school there. And one of the most amazing things about youth is that you have so much ahead of you, right? And you have so much access to knowledge. And so long as you recognize that, again, you don't have to accept things as they are given to you. You don't have to accept the world as it's presented to you by adults, right? And I think that you could go ahead right now and start a social justice club at your school. You can definitely get involved in activism right away, right now. I would love to, maybe we can talk afterwards, I would love to connect you with like some young activists that I know down in North Carolina who are in grade school that are doing a lot of really great things fighting against like the school to prison pipeline and just trying to push for changes in their schools. Young people have always been essential to the movement. I would really encourage you to go look at the Children's Crusade in Birmingham. Look at how involved a lot of young people were in making change happen. So absolutely, absolutely. Good for you.
Hi, my name is Marjorie Stamberg. I'm a New York City public school teacher, a delegate in the United Federation of Teachers, and in a radical caucus there called Class Struggle Education Workers. And Marilyn, I hope you get your job back in Orange, but if not, we would like to have you teaching in our school, I'll tell you. The teachers in New York City to really go to bat for you, and that also means going to bat for Mumia, so I really appreciate that. I wanted to make one point because I'm a Marxist, and I thought listening to Marilyn and listening to Jennicet and listening to Bree, all of you challenged what Karl Marx called the repressive apparatus of the capitalist state. And I am just so inspired by what you did. And that means when Marx talked about that, he was talking about the cops who cannot be reformed because they're there. There's no good apples or bad apples. They're there to exploit and preserve the system of capitalism. So the whole system has got to go. Some of the people now think who have been very active in this movement that we should support Bernie Sanders, because look at the opposition, the horrible Hillary who built sweatshops in Haiti, or Trump, the unspeakable Trump or Bush. But the point I want to make is it, they are all capitalist politicians, and the Sanders campaign is just to sucker you back in to the capitalist Democratic Party. So we need to build our own party, our own Revolutionary Workers' Party. Let me end on a slogan that we all marched on that meant so much to me, and that was Eric Garner, Michael Brown, shut the whole system down. Shut it down with revolution. So thank you.
I don't know if you can hear me. Okay. I'm from Mexico, very proudly from Mexico.
A couple of rallies that my sisters from everywhere have invited me to, and the last one really got through to me because, like always, when women are at the, like in every rally or every march that you go, it's mostly women, but with the People's Powers Assembly and with May 1st women that have accepted me, every single one of them has accepted me and tried to guide me through everything that I've tried, you know, to do and how I try to do it. And the last time that I spoke, I was very clear about how I'm no longer willing to spend my time and my passion and my anger and trying to convince people that I matter. I'm no longer willing trying to convince people that teachers should be encouraging people to be kind to political prisoners, that we should be telling Obama to shut the fuck up, you know? Taking actions on our own. And it's because we are no longer willing to accept this kind of disrespect. And I think that it is one of our main, as women, one of our main objectives to make people see what it is that we're about. And I think that you guys are the representation for us young people right now, because as I was saying to you before, maybe our parents don't want to talk about it, maybe the older people don't want to talk about it, my nieces are talking about you, and my nieces know your name, and I'm also an after school teacher, and they know who you are, and they're talking about it, and they're having opinions, and like this young lady over here, they're asking what to do, and they're moving. So thank you so much. I wanted to thank you personally from a perspective of brown, indigenous, Mexican women, that all you do and all, everything that you will ever do will always matter.
Hi. On behalf of the CUNY Internationalist Club at Hunter College, we thank you and commend your valiant, radical actions
as women of color, as marginalized women, as women systematically forced to the periphery. Your actions hold weight and are absolutely crucial and necessary in the struggle for the liberation of the oppressed, a liberation that can only be forged through a global socialist revolution, a workers' revolution. I think that we can all agree that oppression is absolutely systemic, that it's institutionalized, and it has always been economically beneficial for the capitalist system to oppress, to exploit. And to tackle oppression, we have to get at the root. And for revolutionaries, this root is capitalism, and it is our duty to upheave this system, to quite literally shut the system down through a worker revolution. And so I ask you guys, on behalf of the Internationalist Club, how do you, as three powerful women of color, aim to tackle oppression on an impactful systemic level? And what kind of system do you all believe we should be fighting for? And then another question, as far as Donald Trump was brought up, but we won't talk that much about him. He's often used as an example or the epitome of racism in the United States. We want to know what you have to say about the Democratic Party in regards to racism and oppression within our capitalist system as well. Thank you.
I can jump in. So as I mentioned earlier, I'm a local organizer in Charlotte, and in some ways, honestly, trying to fight systemic oppression feels a little bit like I'm with a teaspoon in the ocean, you know, trying to make change. But really what we're trying to do on a local level, because our system is so broken, and we really can't push for change through legislation, you know, we have people out here trying to change things, you know, through reform and policy. That's great, I support them, if, you know, that's the lane that they run in, but that's obviously not gonna give us the fundamental change that we really need in our community. And so part of what we're really trying to do is, to the greatest extent that we can, organize ourselves so that we are no longer dependent on this system that does not value our lives. What that looks like locally is trying to create our own like local sustained economy. Difficult work, but we're trying. Trying to create alternatives to make sure that our children are educated in places where they feel safe and education that's culturally relevant to them. In terms of the Democratic Party, obviously the Democratic Party is one faction of the one party that controls this country. And I was just talking earlier, about this, that, you know, I'm so tired of being ruled by fear. It's not just the threat of violence, it's also this thing that we go through, especially as Black people, I think everybody relates to it, but just this whole thing that we go through every election cycle, it's almost like this abusive relationship where it's like, you gotta get with me because the other person will be worse to you. And I'm like, that's not very inspiring. You know, so I agree. Obviously, you know, we're probably, unfortunately, not going to have all the changes that we want by November 2016. You know, but I'm hoping, and I am kind of hopeful that I see at least a certain awakening, like in the national consciousness, of starting to become a little bit more aware of what we mean when we talk about systemic oppression, because a lot of people just don't recognize it. You know, especially not on that level. So I am hopeful. I am hopeful for that. The Democratic Party is not the solution, but yeah.
Before I answer, I want to give a big shout out to my amazing people from New York City, trans fam, GNC, people of color. Yes, I'm so inspired by your work also. And then from Oakland, yes, representing in the house. you know, love you too. To dismantle systematic oppression, I think we have to challenge each other, mm-hmm. right? The fact that a trans woman of color is on this panel is a big step, mm-hmm. right? Joining the conversation, mobilizing our communities from the local level to inspire people, because we as trans, gender nonconforming, queer people are always told to sit and just take everything. Right, all the injustices, and which we're supposed to patiently wait until someone comes to the rescue. But I think we are at a moment where we need to come together as a community. I don't think co-opting movements, it's a good way to go about it. I think we have to support each other and find creative ways to attack the system, right? Attack white supremacy. Because if we come together as one single group, the enemy is gonna be easier to destroy us. So forming more groups and resisting, I think that's a very powerful way to fight back. And I was part of a demonstration that I was when Sandra Bland was murdered. And I was like, The person who organized it recognized me and wanted me to share a few words, and I agree, but someone there was like already having conflict with the organization because they claim it wasn't really an LA-based organization, it was more like a national organization getting all the credit. So to me, when it just so happened that when I came to the mic like a minute before, she started like interrupting the space, right? And there's like three local media channels, including CNN. So she's just going on about the people organizing it, the only men basically taking so much space, not letting other voices come into place. So the moment I get on the mic, like, she just totally blew up and interrupted the entire rally. So why is it important for me to share? Because as I left, another lady came to me and said, you know, I saw the action and I support you and I am so proud of what you did. And the lady kept going on, the other lady kept going on and on and on until she started to attack my identity, right? Like, she said, what is this transsexual giving the mic and I'm not? So, and I didn't really take it personal because I knew there was some kind of conflict already setting up. But my point that I want to make, that we need to start making ourselves uncomfortable and starting to have very difficult conversations, that when we can break those barriers down and truly come together as a community and fight back, right? And yes, one last point on that, you know, how we, the LGBTQ community, have sex behind doors. I'm beyond that point, right? Like, I'm moving on to the real issues. Me as a trans woman, what's between my legs, I'm beyond that point. I have other things that I can contribute, and I can really be a voice and a leader. And that goes to other people. And as far as the Democratic Party goes, you know, obviously, as you can tell, I am ineligible to vote. But one day, I was very, I was just voicing my opinion before I became really political consciousness and the injustices, the oppression that they are, both parties doing in collaboration with communities of color. I was all for the Democratic Party, right? Yes, I want someone to go in, a Democrat, to be running this country because it's going to improve our lives. Wrong. It doesn't happen that way. So a person, my coworker, was a Republican, and he just blew up on me. Like, if you vote for the Democrat, and I was, at that time, I was hiding a secret, right? Like, I'm undocumented, and I'm not even supposed to be working here. But okay, I listened to you, and you know, I won't vote for a Democrat. Don't worry, you won't see me at the lines. But so yeah, I mean, to me, both parties are all about the status quo. So we, the masses, have the power to stand up and really, really, really advocate for those most marginalized and oppressed, which in this country are people of color. So I am all about resistance. I'm all about being critical of any person who gets in leadership positions. And if anyone can rule the world, believe me, I would love it to be an LGBTQ people, because we really know how to make tough decisions and survive. Thank you.
So I'm going to speak really quickly to systemic oppression through an educator's perspective. So a lot of my research involves, a lot of my research and work involves, you know, looking at the school-to-prison pipeline and how it functions in our schools currently. And so when you look at policing in schools, it's actually the fastest growing law enforcement field out there right now. So when you look into our schools, there's more police than guidance counselors. So that's a systemic problem that needs to be changed. We need to provide schools with more services that the students actually need, and don't harass them and don't assault them while they're in class and while they're in public, inside public walls. We can also look at funding, right? So the same funding that goes to the criminal justice system is filtered into our schools. And unfortunately, as I mentioned earlier, 3 to 4 times capita goes into incarcerating someone as opposed to educating a student. And so we need to look at those funds, and we need to look at where those funds are going, and they need to go invest into our schools and divest from the criminal justice system. We also need to talk about educational services. There needs to be more educational services in our schools, period. We want to talk about real work. We need to start some freedom schools, and we need to start more community schools in our community. So that's work that needs to be done. As far as the Democratic Party, I think it's just picking the lesser of two evils. I think what we really need is a third political party, and we need to rise up and take over, and we need to do that work.
Hi, my name is Kalia. I'm 17. I go to Kingsborough Community College. I am one of literally maybe 12 black people in my school who are in this advanced track, and I am going to receive my associate's degree hopefully in June of 2016. Quick synopsis. I started college when I was around the 8th grade. I started taking courses back then. I was one of the only black girls who had shape like you did, and a girl of color because I'm mixed, and I was bullied all the time. I went to a predominantly white school, and I speak with white quotas. And I wanted to ask you guys, how do you deal with these quotas, these barriers that people place on you? Because I recently just came out and told my classmate in a public speaking course that my name is Kalia. They would call me Kalia or Korea, and they'd make fun of me, and I established myself, and I feel like me just coming out to my public speaking class about who I am and starting to love who I am and accept who I am is not enough. Like, what else can I do? What else can we do to have people who feel uncomfortable because they're called a wigger, or someone who feels uncomfortable because I'm black and I should be white, is placed on them?
I think the best decision I ever made in my life was the point when I decided I didn't care anymore, what people were no longer gonna dictate who I was, you know what I mean? And I think, and I remember like where I was when I was 17, it was very hard. It was very hard because being who I was not the most socially acceptable, you know, thing at that point. But I would just say, like, if you stay true to who you are, refuse to change, right, you're going to find community. You're going to find yourself surrounded by people who, you know, who respect you and who understand you and who get you. And you don't have to spend your life trying to justify yourself to other people who don't get it, you know?
As a transgender woman of color, I was always told so many times that I didn't exist, that my identity was invaluable, and that my life was disposable. Going into this action, I did take steps to unconsciously see a therapist personally, because I felt that I've been attacked so many times from so many different angles. But at the end of the day, I think you're making a big step in really finding that inner voice. And that's the only one that you should listen to. And it seems like you're going through this process of accepting it and versus what anyone else expects you to be, right? Including the system. Like, the system wants undocumented people who don't speak English to assimilate and speak English, and you have opportunities. And then we get lost in this mix of who we really truly are. And to me, I used to let, including my mother, who gave me birth, like, dictate who I was, right? And I would listen to her voice. I would listen to the voices of my sisters and brothers and my teachers and everyone else. But I think speaking at the interruption, I found my own inner voice. And I think that's the one you should always listen to and continue to fight back. Mm-hmm.
I really just want to build on what both Bree and you said. I think it honestly takes a lot of work with your communities around you. First step is your family. I always feel like I have a lot of work to do within my family, and I still, till this day, do work around my family and claiming who I am and proudly claiming who I am. I think that that's important work. I also think that self-care is really important, which both of you mentioned. And then also, building community around you will keep you alive. I think that there's a lot of folks around me that keep me alive on a daily basis. You can't do it on your own. You know, we want to be superwomen, and in a lot of ways we can be. We're powerful as individuals, but we also need community. It's just a human trait that's very natural. Belonging to organizations, joining organizations that you feel are really aligned with your politics, are aligned with your ideologies, that's really important as well to build that community and to have that community to support you through these struggles.
Yes, I'm glad. I was had some trepidation if I was to bring up anything about the politics, because I know some of you see my socialist alternative teacher, and I want to start by saying, because I support a lot of what the socialist alternative and Green Party are doing, because they're both working with Black Lives Matters. But by doing that and supporting decarceration, they're also supporting the 15 now, and then also taking the dollars from these the prison pipeline, putting them back into community schools, and not something like Obama's affordable health care, but single payer health care, true health care, community schools, actual jobs in construction and green energy. So instead of promoting prison and broken glass window policing, they're also focused on the right policing, the community policing. So what I would like to ask, and the big center of the opportunity for, is how can I work with you and talk to you some more about educating some of the voters about some of these topics. I know Black Lives Matter is a theme, hands up, don't shoot, all of that, that's known, but particularly Moral Monday is really mostly known just in the Southeast. Some of us know about it in the Northeast, but I know a lot of voters who don't. So how can I have the chance and the opportunity to talk to some of you some more and work with our voter outreach and educating people about those who will make a difference and who will not be the two-party duopoly. So I'd be glad to work with you on that. Thank you.
Representing undocumented students. I'd just like to give a background. I am a citizen. I was informed that I'm the second citizen in the organization. The rest are undocumented. I was told I could be facing political and social issues. But hearing you, very amazing woman, I would just like to know if you guys have any advice for me facing this. I mean, I know I am not afraid. I know this is something I feel passionate about. I believe that every immigrant, every undocumented person here has the same capability, has the same chance to succeed. That's my personal stand where I believe, which is why I support so deeply CUNY Dreamers and the undocumented students. But what advice would you give me on that point? Socially and politically, what I would be facing. Socially and politically, what advice could you guys give me to continue and to not be intimidated by such issues?
Okay. I mean, I think what you're doing is completely on point. I mean, I often get the question how do I get involved in activism? And what I always say is match your passion to, your skill set. And plug yourself in, and that seems to be absolutely what you are doing. In terms of getting over your fear, let me tell you something, just honest, full disclosure, 5 years ago, I never would have thought that I would have been an activist, especially not an organizer. I mean, I really had to there was a lot of social anxiety that I had to overcome. And when I first got involved in activism, and I had a friend who was an organizer, and he told me, you're an organizer, you should, go into organizing. I was like, nah, I can't. knocking on doors, talking to people, all of that is like, even, you know, things like this, you know, a little bit intimidating. But again, I think that oftentimes, honestly, shy people, the people who are most afraid, who overcome that fear, end up being some of the most powerful people, simply because there's clearly something inside of you, right, that allows you to overcome that fear. Even you overcame whatever nervousness you're feeling right now at the microphone, you know what I mean? So you totally have it inside of you. You just continue to foster it. You're going to be powerful. Like, just keep going. Keep going. It's already there.
I spoke to an activist. I was part of an action, the Fight for 15. Woman in LA organized this event where they were fasting for 15 days to bring the campaign to the public and educate them what they were so important for them to fight. And there was a very amazing activist there whose name is Bon Bon. I don't know if anyone is familiar with her work. She was very active in the 60s. And I was so inspired by that moment and that particular action of fasting, right? Because to me, that is a very strong message, but you have to specifically strategize and be very careful how you're going to go through the 15 days of fasting, making sure you have a lot of things involved. So what she said to me, and I asked her a similar question, like, what do I have to do? Because it feels like, this was before the action, like, how can I continue to get involved? And she said, you know, it's no, I'm going to paraphrase what she said. So she said, it's not going to get easy. It's going to get more difficult each time. But you have to align yourself with people who support you and have similar interests in the fights that you want to fight and be ready to unite them and fight back. And I think you also pointed something very important, which was your privilege, right? You're organizing yourself with mostly undocumented people, and you say you're a citizen. So also that's something everyone should be checking daily, right? Or privilege of what do we do? How do we join this community? So yes, keep doing what you're doing. I used to be very shy. I used to be embarrassed to speak up and always in the back listening. And yes, you know, it's been very, very quiet. And look, it took a White House invitation to to raise my voice and find that strength and courage. And now I'm gonna continue to fight.
I absolutely agree with what Jennicet said. I think that we need to be more proactive about what we want. Like, you manipulate spaces just like this to get to know folks that you aspire to be or that you admire. And so never be afraid to go up to someone. And one of my best friends always told me, if you see someone who you admire, go up to them and say, can you be my mentor? Because that's what you really need. You need people around you that are gonna support you. And so one of my mentors is in the room right now, Bree Newsome, and she was my professor in undergrad. And so I recognized her. She was one of the first people that introduced me to the idea of what even social justice is. And so I kept in touch with her, and she's been one of the biggest supporters throughout my case, and she's been advocating for me hard. And so, you know, it's not just about admiring them and aspiring to be them and learning from them, but having that mutual support with each other and having and building that important relationship is so, so critical.
Hi, how are you? My name is Dominique. So first of all, I wanted to thank you for sharing what you have been sharing, especially in the points where you had doubts in regards to moving forward. That's definitely things that I needed to hear today. I am myself a deferred action recipient, so which means that I'm undocumented, but I have deferred action. And I also work with youth who are undocumented, and I myself got involved in the same organization when I was younger. And I wanted to honor right now your families. A lot of you were sharing things about you wanted to, as you were planning actions or as you were choosing things for your community, you have some conflicts with your family, and I wanted to bring that to the center. Also because that's just a reality for a lot of us who take steps that past the threshold of how much our parents or people that we call family, whatever you define that, can accept. But it's the people that we love the most, and it's people that we want to also support us and work with us, and it's like an internal fight at home. And I also want to say that because I want to hear a little bit of your thoughts on that, how you fight that, how you work around that for the youth that I organize with, including myself and the same context that I have within my home, but also for the young girl who asked the question regarding about how what the kids can do. It's just a reality that will come up, I'm guessing, because it's been the reality for many of us. So that's my question, and thank you.
Yeah, can you say your question again? Sorry.
The question is, so you spoke about conflict within your families as you were moving forward in your actions or your growth as an activist. And I want you to talk a little bit more on that, if that's okay with you, because of the younger who asked a question about what kids can do, but also because I work with young people myself, and I had the same conflicts at home. And I know you spoke about it a little bit, but I wanted to, that's just a reality that many people who take this path face.
Yeah, absolutely. It's easier in a lot of ways for me because I'm an adult, you know, in terms of stepping out. I mean, I'm glad and I feel really fortunate that I've gotten a lot of support from my family in terms of the activism that I do. You know, it scares them a lot of times. I think some of the whatever pushback I get from my family has more to do with concerns over, you know, my safety. And just, you know, the possible consequences that come with choosing to be an activist. Which is why I even all the more admire, especially like young people and, you know, people who are like under 18 who take that step. I admire the bravery of Jennicet. Like, I mean, to really have to assert your identity in that way is amazing. I have not, you know, That's kind of like a place of privilege that I come from. I've not really had to do that in that way within my family, you know. So I've not quite dealt with that same kind of pushback from my family. Maybe somebody else can speak a little bit more to what that experience is like.
I guess part of that conflict with the family, yes, I do believe families are the backbone of our existence of our work that we do. It was a process. Like, I had to process and come to terms with who I am as a trans woman. I think they had to go through that process themselves. And at that moment, I wanted to like listen to my mom, but then I felt like she didn't support me. But now, like, all my family, it's behind me 100%. They support any activism. They haven't told me don't do it anymore. They have been really, really behind. And for the very first time in San Francisco a week ago, I was at a community forum, and like some of my family showed up at that event. And to me, that was very symbolic, because another panelist was like, I've been in activism for so long, and it's rare to see a trans woman activist family supporting their work, because we're already so rejected, we're so marginalized, like, why are you gonna be visible where people are gonna hate you even more, right? So it's just that the process that we go through, but at the end of the day, I do believe that we need to depend on them for emotional support and love, and continue to work for our mission. And I gave a speech at a college in California, and a young student came to me and he said, I'm so thankful for what you did. Both my parents are undocumented, but they don't see like LGBTQ as an immigration issue. Like, how do I get over that? And he was almost in tears. And I could relate to that, because at one point my family didn't want, like, for example, with the Obama promised immigration reform within the first year of office. And we have discussions at home before I transitioned, and there even my family was like, I hope the LGBT community doesn't jump in. They wanted to be part of the reform, because any chances, they're gonna dissolve it, because it's gonna create a lot of controversy, it's gonna divide people. So I think having these difficult conversations and understanding that at the end of the day, regardless of our labels, we are human beings and we all want better lives and those opportunities to thrive, and we'll overcome stuff.
Thank you.
So I think that that's one of my biggest personal struggles is dealing with my family on a daily basis. And if I were to address every single ignorant comment that a family member made, I think it would be my job. It would be a 24/7 job. And so just realizing that you need to choose your battles wisely, and sometimes it's not always the best to do it so aggressively. Sometimes it's good to do it through jokes or through laughing and make them realize how ridiculous they're being. Right, and so, and also make them realize the fundamental that the personal is the political, right? And so one of the most beautiful moments after my case was at the second board meeting when, you know, all my fellow community organizers, my fellow educators, my fellow activists came together in that room. Not only were they there, but my family members were there too. And so there was one moment with all the chaos going on, everyone chanting and screaming and giving their own testimonies, where I looked around the room to see not just organizers and activists, but my family members chanting, "Let her teach." And it was just one of the most beautiful moments of my life for those to intersect. And it wasn't because, it was because that the root of that, the root cause of everyone being in that room was love, right? And so everyone came around the idea of love and the need for love, the love for the students, the love for me, the love for the community, the love for education. All of it was about love. And so I think we need to keep that in mind when we struggle with our family members as well.
Hi everyone, my name is Alexia. I'm a CUNY student. I'm also a member of the CUNY Internationalist Club at Hunter College. I really want to thank the speakers for coming. I want to thank the PPA and the May 1st Coalition for putting on this event and bringing everyone into this room, into this space. Many of my fellow members here in this room have mentioned that it is a systemic problem. We're not talking about individual like bad apples or just this one president that is doing these things to our people. So what does that mean if it's a systemic problem? Well, I would say it doesn't matter if there's a black president, a woman president, it could be an LGBTQ president dressed in a rainbow suit. The same system will keep killing black, brown, immigrant, women, people with different handicaps, and those who we say we are defending and uplifting and honoring their names will still be killed if we don't change the whole system. Wow, that's a big task. What does that mean? I want to thank Marilyn Zuniga. She mentioned, I think it's time to build a third party. That means going against the Democrats. What does that third party look like? It's a workers' revolutionary party. A workers' party means those who create, who touch, who bring us everything that is in this room and in our homes and in our schools are the ones who should be dictating how our government should be run. Just look around this room. Look at the microphone I'm talking to you with. This is probably made by someone in China or India or Honduras. We should be uplifting these people, these black, brown men, women, and children who make these things for our behalf. If we say we are building a revolutionary workers' party, that means it is also a global undertaking. That means from the 43 disappeared students in Ayotzinapa to those sweatshop laborers in Haiti, who are now being deported because of the racist laws in the Dominican Republic. And we're talking about what's happening in Greece as well. We're seeing an uprising. These are the people all around the world we have to fight for. So I just want to add that the CUNY Internationalist Club, we are students and faculty members educating fellow student and faculty members to support the working class so they can smash this racist capitalist state and build a revolutionary socialist movement around the world so we can uplift human dignity and know what it means like to live in
prosperity. Thank you so much for your time.
All right, we have two more questions. Maybe three. Or comments. Quickly, guys.
Hello.
No more questions after these three, okay?
Hello, I'm Leila Khalil, and I know we said which areas we're representing, but I'm here representing Seattle and queer and trans Muslims, and we are coming out visible as well. All right, so I guess to add to the systemic shit show that we live in, I just want to say we've seen lately that, you know, we have stories like, you know, queer and trans identities being pinkwashed in the Middle East, where settler colonial white supremacy is taking over indigeneity of the Arab community. We have people, you know, for the last 15 years, we've been living in a state where Islamophobia has definitely been very, 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 very visible. And now all of a sudden, there's a kid with a clock who's being lifted up by all of these capitalist, you know, white supremacist models who are starting to say, welcome to the buffer zone, Mr. Muhammad Ahmed. And so I guess my real question was gonna be, how do you maintain hope in such a shitty, shitty situation where all of your identities continue to be used to perpetuate very, very awful white supremacy? How do you keep your hope? And even when you don't have, you know, when coming out isn't necessarily the easiest thing to do, it's not necessarily the thing that is the safest thing for everybody. How do you move forward? How do you keep your hope? Thank you.
I mean, that's part of why I consider it such a blessing to be in this movement, because I think part of, like, the only reason I haven't lost my mind in terms of, like, you know, seeing everything that has been going on is because daily I get to be around people who are working to make change. And you know, I get to at least feel like I know that I'm, you know, making whatever effort I can towards it. And then just honestly, I really believe that this system is unnatural. I don't believe it is the natural state of human beings to be oppressed. And I think that one way or the other, it's going to come down. Like I absolutely, somebody was asking me that the other day, like, you know, do you think it's ever gonna change? I think it is. I think the question is just how. Like, is it going to be a complete collapse? Is it going to be violent? Is it going to be some kind of like peaceful change? But I think that the status quo is completely unsustainable for all the reasons that people stated before. The status quo necessitates oppression. You can't have liberation is at odds with the status quo, right? But oppression is also at odds with the natural state of human beings, which is to be free. And so I think my hope comes from that, and sometimes it is very dark and it is extremely depressing. But that's what gets me up every day and keeps me going. I have to remember that, you know, there was a time when in this country they thought that we would never have emancipation. You know, that was something that seemed like completely impossible, and had people just accepted, well, it can never change, then, you know, they would have never put themselves on the line for it. So I got to put myself on the line for the hope for the future. For the girl who came up here and stood earlier and asked what she could do, I'm like, man, I got to get up and work extra hard tomorrow, you know?
I just continue to believe in myself. I mean, all this criticism and bringing me down each time, because they do want that hope to die. And they do want my existence to die. Mm-hmm. So you don't challenge the status quo and really make change. So just continue to love yourself, continue to push forward. And one way that I inspire myself, it's by reading amazing people who have resisted in the past, who have challenged the system. And something, it's, you learn something and bring it to your community, bring it to your family, bring it to the people that you surround yourself with. And I think that we do believe to be in a position that change can happen if we mobilize people and provide an alternative soon.
Yeah, so I think that there's been times where I question myself of whether, you know, I should have gotten myself into this situation, and kind of internalized the words of my father of like, well, you did something wrong and you have to deal with the consequences now. But, you know, it's just moments like that that make you work that much harder and that make you pursue what you were pursuing in the first place. It's moments like that that you start to doubt yourself when you really start to believe in yourself. And what helps me the most is also reading about our ancestors and reading about what folks have done in the past and watching history, right? And so, like, watching history unfold in front of your eyes, there's something so beautiful, something so powerful about what's going on in the world right now. And so we're in so much turmoil, we're experiencing so much trauma, but we're also experiencing so much beauty around us. And so focus in on that beauty and to let your energy just kind of embrace that beauty that is going on and that good work that is being done is just absolutely amazing. I just recently actually came from the Dominican Republic to meet, I went there about a couple weeks ago. Actually, I came back less than a month ago. And I was there meeting with a lot of organizations and grassroots organizations that are doing work around the denationalization of Dominicans of Haitian descent. And it was so powerful to see what they were doing. And while there was so much struggle in it, and while there was so much ugliness in what the state had done to them, there was so much beauty in their reclamation of that. And so, you know, they sat there and said, "Somos negras," and they were proud of it. And so it was just so much beauty in that and so much power in that to realize that this work is not just being done by you, but by people around the world.
Yeah.
All right, last two.
Buenas noches a todos. Yo especialmente, me llamo Fabiola Pérez. Soy de México y pues yo soy una persona muy muy inquieta.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Fabiola and I am from Mexico.
Mira, la pregunta es para ti. Yo te quiero.
The question is for you.
Yo te quiero dar gracias en nombre de toda la comunidad transgénero de todos. Por todo el mundo, quizás.
She wants to thank me personally on behalf of the transgender community around the world.
Muchísimas gracias por hablar por nosotras, por todas las organizaciones donde estamos y yo específicamente yo no me voy sin darte las gracias de todo corazón porque yo tengo muchas preguntas para ti. Desgraciadamente el tiempo no, tal vez es.
Permíteme. She just wants to thank on behalf of the community and for being present here today that she has a lot of questions for me, but she doesn't know how much time she has.
Lo único que te digo es muchísimas gracias, que Dios te bendiga, y yo pienso que si tú has pasado todo esto, las puertas se te van a abrir más especialmente a ti, y pues que estamos contigo y que Nueva York y en todas partes del mundo estamos contigo y te apoyamos.
Gracias, gracias.
Siempre estaremos contigo.
Gracias.
Gracias a ti. Es todo.
She just said she wanted to thank me and may God bless me and the entire community in New York. It's behind me, especially the transgender community, and that my action and the visibility, the interruption at the White House is going to open more doors, and she's very proud of the work that we're doing. And I just want to add something to that response. First Spanish and then English. It'll be fast, because I know it's getting very late. But muchísimas gracias por esas palabras de apoyo. Creo que donde la acción hubo even mucho desacuerdo con nosotras mismas, atacándome, que ridícula, maricón con vestido, faltándole el respeto al presidente, o sea, mucho crítica, ¿verdad? Entonces, oír esas palabras de apoyo significan mucho. Y nada más quiero decir, a mí me preguntaron en un apoyo ahí en Los Ángeles, dice, ¿tú en México o en no le faltarías el respeto al presidente? En Cuba tampoco lo harías. So mi respuesta para ellas fue, no me conoces. Porque en México o en Cuba, si hay injusticias, yo voy a interrumpir a cualquier líder que esté ahí. Y lo que me dijo, pues te van a matar. Oh, pues si, si ese es el sacrificio que tengo que dar por haber un cambio, bienvenido. So I just want to very quickly, because I know we're running out of time, but I know there was a lot of criticism with the interruption within the own transgender community attacking my character, attacking my own identity, right? What is that? Quote unquote, you know, very transphobic remarks within ourselves. And they were like, you wouldn't be disrespectful at a president in Mexico, you wouldn't be disrespectful at a president in Cuba. And my response to them was like, you don't know me. Mm-hmm. Right? I said I would. So, well, if you do that, then they're going to kill you. I said, well, if that is the ultimate sacrifice that I have to pay for change, so be it. Thank you.
I just want to thank you for a really wonderful, amazing evening and a discussion that was unbelievably great because it was so personal. And this is going to seem as a strategy question. Where do you come down on the division, the fight within both the left and the black community around public and charter schools? Because many people have been upset with public schools because they have been failing, and some of the people who want to do things like freedom schools or, you know, alternative schools do go to the charter school movement in both left and people of color communities. And full disclosure, I was raised in Chicago, went to an inner city, meaning mainly working class and not white, you know, public school. My son graduated about less than 10 years ago from a New York City inner city public school, and I just want to know where all of you stand, because first I was going to just ask Marilyn, but it's really, we all are raising our children, so it's everybody's business.
So first of all, I 100% support public education. I came up through public education. We need well-funded public education. We need education funded, period. Education should obviously be like one of our top priorities. Education should be free and available for everybody. I think if we did that, it would 5 years tops, the whole thing would topple, which is why they're not gonna do that. but I understand why you have so many parents pushing, you know, to get their children into charter schools. And you know, in North Carolina, obviously there's a huge attack going on right now on the public schools and on teachers. You have a lot of parents, obviously, who are desperate to get their children better resources, and they think that, you know, charter schools are the answer. And in some cases, I have seen some charter schools where they have a little bit more freedom in terms of the education. One of my friends, she switched to a public school now, but before that, she was in a charter school, and she felt that she had a little bit more freedom in terms of particularly the curriculum she was able to lay out for her black students, who, you know, she's able to talk to them about like black history and other things that kind of get skipped over. However, I think it's really important that people understand, and this is one of the things that we're trying to help parents in my community really understand, that the charter school movement really is fundamentally about trying to end public education. Because public education is one of the main routes that people have towards economic mobility and towards, you know, liberation. It's a tool, it's a way, it can be an avenue if it were properly funded towards liberation. And so that's one of the things that we are really trying to help parents understand, that we've got to fight for public schools. This fight that's going on right now between public and charter schools over the scarcity of resources is the scarcity of resources shouldn't exist to begin with. You know, and so we really have to push back against that.
I'm a supporter of a public education as well. In Mexico, we also have a similar system, because everything the U.S. does that Mexico wants to emulate, right, especially when it's so popular. And I was also part of a private school, and I think if I could, from those experiences, I said, I believe that one thing I will challenge is the standardized test, because a test really doesn't dictate your intelligence or your capacity, what you can provide to the system and to the world. I believe that we need to find different ways to really allow people to thrive in different ways. And I also believe that education is a tool to challenge power. So it should be always accessible to people.
I could talk about this all day. So there's multiple reasons and multiple layers to why I don't support the charter school movement. And a lot of that has to do with the privatization of our public schools and how, you know, corporations have their hands on our textbooks, they have their hands on our curriculum, police have our hands on have their hands on our curriculum clearly. So we need to fight against that. They're also taking out neighborhood schools that have been there for generations after generations after generations. And so communities are standing there and looking at schools that they went to generations ago that they want their kids and their grandkids to go to, and they can't because now they're charter schools and they're renamed all these other names. I also want to emphasize the fact that charter schools use raffling processes to, like, they use raffling to select their students, and so it's just another way of tracking. They actually do, a lot of charter schools use the process of selecting who comes into their schools, and so this is just farther pushing out students who don't have access to good education. It's pushing out students who are classified because they claim to not have services for those students. It's pushing out students who are Black and brown and who are systemically pushed out of schools to begin with. And so we, students with disabilities, exactly, and they don't have those special services in those schools. And so this is really important to critique, and this is really important to keep in mind. And so I have made a political, personal decision to not accept any offers from charter schools because when asked, you know, sometimes people ask me, why don't you do a private school? Why don't you do a charter school? You might have more freedom with the curriculum. Well, that's great, but that's not where the students are at, right? And so that's where I want to be. I want to be where the students are at.
I'm going to briefly add a quick question. I know everyone's waiting. I'm just going to throw it in. And then we're going to start to close. But I wanted to end thinking about inspiration and motivation and the movement going forward. I was so inspired by these elements in each of your talks. Marilyn, you really told this very personal story that I think a lot of people of color can relate to. About being in white spaces. Jennicet, I really appreciate also the way you brought the folks we've lost into this space, which has been highly important to our current movements. And Bree, you really talked about carrying communities with us. And I think these are elements that are very particular to these current movements, mm-hmm. to the spirit of women, queer, trans leadership that we have in the stage. And as someone who is in the space of the academy, in the space of activism, I'm constantly told that I must understand my oppression through the eyes of white men and not by my own experiences, not by the losses I've had in my community. So I was inspired by these personal elements to your stories that I think help us understand these issues. And I'd love to hear what inspires each of you individually in terms of the movement going forward, just because I think leaving with a note of inspiration is really important.
Man, what inspires me in terms of the movement going forward? It's honestly like I love doing the panels like this, and it's great like when I get to talk, but the best part for me is like speaking with people afterward. And just realizing like even in this far out, like
how many people are still plugging in. Like, I actually love it when people ask me, how can I become an activist? Because that means that's somebody who's now getting in the movement. And I get that question everywhere I go, which means that there are more people who are joining in. So I'm just inspired by the fact that this is going to keep going. I remember, you know, this time last year, everybody was like, is this a moment or a movement? Is this a moment or a movement? Is this a moment or a movement? It's a movement, and we're not gonna stop.
I think personally what inspires me is the community. You know, transgender people, gender non-conforming people, queer people of color, I think they really truly know and understand what needs to be done in order to challenge. And just being part of the knowing, I also found inspiration through the dreamers. Right, like knowing that undocumented people do have a space in the U.S. regardless of their documentation status, and realize that they can truly shift power and the narrative, and allowing us to join the table, to join the discussion. That to me is very inspiring. Personally, when I did the interruption, and then Breeze was 3 days later, just watching her action truly uplifted my spirit and really inspired me to continue to fight. And to, you know, it was just very moving and very touching, and I just broke down, and I'm still trying to process and debrief everything that I just went through. But seeing other courageous acts, especially from women who always have been told to sit in the back and let the main lead, right? There's the famous saying, behind a gray man, there's a woman. Like, no, the woman has always been in front, and the voices should be in the front at all times. So those are the things that inspire me, and I will continue to be inspired and to inspire people. So thank you.
What inspires me is, yes, one, community, but also children and youth. And so when I think about why I got into education in the first place, I always tell people what's been the most miserable part about all of this is having to look at adults every day as opposed to kids. Like, I used to love walking in my room in the morning and seeing like bright, shiny faces, excited to learn. Like, that is so beautiful when youth are excited to learn, and it's so beautiful to be able to experience their energy. I encourage all of you to look up a really powerful student group in Newark, the Newark Student Union. They're doing amazing work, and they inspire me every day. And also, I want to specifically say one of my students' names, Kashmir Jones, who came out and spoke at one of our town hall meetings that we had, a political education to engage the community of Orange. And people spoke about Mumia, people spoke about culturally relevant pedagogy, social justice teaching. And Kashmir came up to me at the town hall meeting and he said, "Ms. Zuniga, can I speak?" And I said, "Absolutely." And he went up there and spoke about how it's so important to have a teacher like myself in the classroom. And I will absolutely never have a more proud moment than that moment.
Speaking of inspiration and community, and to thank you all, we just wanted to
All right, keep standing. We're gonna end this with the Asada chant. I want you guys to hold your neighbor's hand and repeat after me. We're gonna do it three times, and the third time, I want to hear you. All right. It is our duty to fight for our freedom.
It is our duty to fight for our freedom.
It is our duty to win.
It is our duty to win.
We must love and support each other.
We must love and support each other.
We have nothing to lose but our chains.
We have nothing to lose but our chains.
It is our duty to fight for our freedom.
It is our duty to win.
We must love and support each other.
We must love and support each other.
We have nothing to lose but our chains.
We have nothing to lose but our chains.
It is our duty to fight for our freedom.
It is our duty to fight for our freedom.
It is our duty to win.
It is our duty to win.
We must love and support each other.
We must love and support each other.
We have nothing to lose but our chains.